Right, I'm going to kick off the digital marketing show. Since there's so few of you, I'm going to ask you to introduce yourselves.
My name's Helen.
Helen, hello. What do you do?
I run a jewellery business, a luxury jewellery brand.
Okay, fantastic.
Yeah. My name's Melanie, and I work for a fine arts publisher.
Okay, yeah. Fantastic.
Hi, I'm Selena from eStyler, and I've just launched a fashion website for graduate fashion designers.
Okay, fantastic.
My name is Naheen. I don't have a business at the moment.
Just checking us out.
Yeah.
That's okay. And what about you?
Hello, I'm Fionn. I work for a foreign exchange trading firm.
Right, okay. Thank you.
Well, I prepared a short presentation on luxury marketing. Is that of interest? Sounds like it. It's quite high level, and it's quite global as well. But I'm very happy to just take questions, and we can just make it very interactive. These sorts of things kind of can end up being quite... well, there's not very many of them. I'd like to turn you into the panel rather than you ask me questions. I'd like to ask you questions. So what I'm here to do, to talk about today, can you hear me okay? Is a little bit of a discussion about what is, you know, it says here, what is the luxury market? You know, for those that are new to it, it's not Pepsi Max. It's not necessarily premium. And I'm going to talk specifically today, and I hope that's all right, about high net worth individuals, because that's a big part of what my agency is involved in dealing with. A little bit of a discussion about who's in the Millionaires Club. If you're new to luxury, it's a rapidly growing part of the world's economy. You know, there are more millionaires now than there have ever been, and that's not going to stop. But I think in terms of branding, it's critical that you know, people still buy from you because they believe in what you believe. So having a point of view and a strategy for the brand that's really very focused on values that are like-minded values is important. Craftsmanship, authenticity, provenance, though, all those things matter, and some content strategy is really critical as well, because often luxury brands, remarkably, don't actually invest that much in marketing. They invest quite a lot in the brand, and if the more fashion end they are, they kind of develop a lot of it themselves as well. So, interesting to talk about that. And I'm going to talk mostly as well today about cars, luxury vehicles. Okay, that's as the specific topic. I know some of you are not are more into fashion. We can talk about that after, okay? Since you've probably never heard of me or anything that we get up to, I'll just show you this, which is a little description of some of the things that my company does. I'll do it this way, I think. Just a quick overview. We're an agency that builds, I suppose, equity with the market, combining creativity and technology, we call it. So it's, if you like, classical communications, but blended with a development unit that builds configurations and tool sets and environments. So it's quite an interesting little business, actually. But today, I think that one of the questions that we were asked to, you know, talk about luxury, what is it? Is a big definition. You know, this is, everyone been here? Sistine Chapel? It's amazing, isn't it? And it's a sort of pricelessness to it, actually. But I think that, you know, luxury has many definitions, but it's sort of things, in a way, what you don't need. If you look at Maslow's, you know, hierarchy of needs, luxury isn't really, you know, the basic needs aren't there, but actually it's turning, you know, creating a proposition, if you like, or a property that is something that, in a way, people don't need it, but you, the whole idea of building brands and luxury is to ensure that it's the thing that everybody really wants. So creating a strong story and a strong narrative around the brand is really important. And I think when we talk about it, you know, I was interviewed recently by the Financial Times about our Bugatti work, and it was quite interesting. The definitions are really clear. You know, when you talk about, does anyone know the definite a high net worth individual? We use a lot of technical terms, HNWI, you know, an ultra high net worth individual. It's somebody who has $30 million of liquid income. They're not like you and me, I'm afraid. One day maybe, but in general, they live a very different life. And in general, their lives have changed dramatically over the years to get to where they are now. So creating stories and narrative that appeals to them is important. And understanding a bit of where they are is important as well. So they're all, quite an interesting chart from Luxury Society and another bit of research in that, you know, there's a prediction, it says there, you know, 20, you know, now there'll be an increase in centimillionaires over the next 5 years by these numbers, which you can see, you know, 15% more in Japan. We do a lot of business in China, 106, you know, the centimillionaires in China will double over the next 5 years. If you think about it, it's a massively industrializing nation, and it's moved rapidly from an economy that it's not particularly engaged with the rest of the world to one that actually will dominate the rest of the world. So thinking about, if you're building brands now that are involved in luxury, think about the China market as a place where you can go. And don't forget America. You know, we all think of, you know, America's still a place where they buy a lot of luxury. It's important to them. But the attitudes that people have towards luxury in those markets can vary quite dramatically. What they invest in can vary quite dramatically. So, for example, you know, jewelry is the number one personal investment. Now, people invest in wine in the States, less so in the Middle East. And there's also an attitude about what they're investing in. Is it something that's for me, or is it something that's going to help me show off to my friends? And there's a very important cultural complexity to that, that is a moving feast. There are some constants in that, depending if it's where money has come from, if it's inherited, then that tends to bring a certain attitude. But if it's self-made, that brings another attitude. So think about where your customers are, or these people are in their life's journey. I know, are they, the question we get asked, do they use, you know, is it e-commerce good for luxury? Well, absolutely it is. These people, like everybody, they have, I would describe a characteristic, if you're familiar with what we describe as a high need for cognition. They're the sort of people who are quite, if they've made money, they're the sort of people who can make decisions really quickly, but they like to consume an enormous amount of information also really quickly. So having, you know, applications that provide all the data they need to make decisions is really important, actually. They have what we describe as, or I would describe as, a higher need for cognition. And just as an attitude and a mindset, it's important to think about that, because the digital world creates masses of opportunity to put stuff into the ether and to create content that's going to appeal to people, that gives them information which they like. So yeah, they are online. And you think of Vertu as a brand, for example, targeting that space. And I think there's another point to make about who they are. We talk about attitudinal segments. Is anyone familiar with that kind of segmentation of attitudes? You know, depending on where people are, you know, there's studies that are done. So we work with a company called Sigma, which does a sort of international study of everyone, basically, and categorizes them into segmentations. And at the top end of the market, we kind of, I guess there's sort of, we could describe as three, if you like, that we could look at, because they have different attitudes. If we describe one group as classic, inherited money, you describe another group as progressive, inherited and dynamically developed money, and another group as flamboyant, often self-made. But equally, people's money come from doesn't necessarily put them into these attitudinal categories, but it does kind of define what they think about in terms of what they do with their money. So classic tends to be a little bit more traditional. They'll buy traditional brands, Rolls-Royce, you know, all of these traditional brands. Flamboyant, a bit more, they're out there, they want to be at the shows, they're much more fashion-oriented, they dress well, they like to be seen. So it's who you see in the media, if you like, kind of defines these people. But what it also does, it helps us think about what it is that they're interested in. So, you know, Jerry Bruckheimer is an example of one of these sorts of characters. And you can actually almost put names, I mean, you can, and that's a case of actually putting names onto them. But I think another point to make, as you try to build a story with these people, is think about where they've been and where they're going. Because as I said to you, when you make money, your life changes dramatically over time. And I think this, you might know this guy. It's quite a nice little piece which describes a journey that he's been on.
I was 20 years old. I'm already like a millionaire. And diamond watch, car, crash, buy another one, nightclub, women. Then, why am I suddenly doing so many charity? Enough. I'm ready to have everything. But sometimes I sit down. Diamond watch? No. Car? Enough. Women? A lot of trouble. Ah! You're helping people. You see the children smiling. Wow. It makes you comfortable. And suddenly, doing a charity teach me becoming a humble, becoming a good person.
So Jackie Chan started a foundation, educational foundation, later on in his life. And I think that reflects an element of what's going on in these guys' minds. You know, sorry, it's bouncing forward a bit fast here. A couple of big shifts that are going on. You know, from, in general, money is moving from an inherited wealth to a self-made wealth. Again, that's sort of big picture stuff. And secondly, you know, for example, I've got some statistics here. In Europe, 30% of money is self-made. In Asia, 47%. Middle East, 50%. You know, in India, 63% of the centimillionaire community are self-made. In Brazil, it's even higher, 73%. So you look at that, BRICS, self-made money happening big time. You know, Europe, a little bit more classical. And this other idea as well of being people that have come from nowhere. You know, there's that sense, that's the American dream, isn't it? I can do from nowhere, I can be anybody. But I think that as they take on a responsibility in life, and one of the cultural characteristics that becomes really important is an understanding that these people are role models for others. So that's the journey, if you like, that Jackie Chan has been on, from being somebody who just wanted to be famous, just wanted to make films, actually, have fun, be famous, and now it's much more about legacy and what he can do for the community and a contribution to society, which is a huge change in how people see their money. There was a time when the wealthy hid their money. In fact, they still do. But hiding and kind of keeping it away from the public domain is an important aspect of wealth. But also, doing good with your money is becoming an important thing, because that's actually what matters. There's a real shift in the newer generations of the wealth to thinking about what they can do as a force for good, which is something to think about if you are building a story about your brand or you're creating a new brand. If it's a brand for good, that's an important thing. If you can associate yourselves in that way, good to think about. Another point to make is that these things, these attitudes, if you like, can shift by the region that they're in. So for example, and if you've been to the States, it's very sort of selfish culture almost, but the individual, the role of the individual, everything is about me. Is that story? You know, me, 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 me. You know lots of people like that, I'm sure. It's a very Western behavior pattern. Asia, a little bit more focused on family. You know, Richard Branson says that in the West, corporations make empires, and in the East, they make dynasties. I've worked with the Tata Group, for example. It's very much like that. It's about dynastical approach, a long-term approach to investment. You know, 30, 40, 100-year investment, which is very different from the Wall Street quarterly reporting structures that most of us operate under. And in China, I think it's important as well that the attitude is very much about the common good, or the collective, has a massive part to play in business. Whilst there's a new world, a new generation of money being invented and created there, it's also one where attitudes to the whole are really important. So people do think about society, and in fact it's a very legislated environment, it's a government-led world. So government says do this, everybody goes, okay. There's no kind of, well, actually, I don't think that's a good idea. They just do it, because that's just the cultural mentality. Throwing a lot of numbers at you today. I don't mean to be too technical, really, but you know, the younger, there's attitude as well. The younger you are, the more you spend on yourself. And I've got children, that's the same, actually. The more they want me to spend on them, actually. But as you get a little bit older, then and as you get into your, if you like, wealth management as opposed to your wealth creation, then wealth management is often more about buying things for others and buying, for example, collectibles that ascertain value over time. And I think it's, trying to find a motivation as well for people is critical. And I just there's one particular brand that we worked with is a yacht business, which kind of unlocked. They were very much into this idea of, you know, we make brilliant things. You know, it's a thing culture. Actually, to build that longer-term appeal, you have to decide on a set of values that are interesting people. So in this instance, you know, we worked and did research with the audience, with the customers, and with the business to unlock a sense of, actually, why do people go boating? And it's not it's not necessarily to show off. It's actually because they enjoy it, and there's that sense of enjoyment. And as with this particular audience, we interviewed quite a few people around the world who had quite a lot of money, but not a lot of time. Actually, it was that enjoyment. You know what? I just really enjoy doing it. So unlocking a sense of enjoyment and a sense of adventure was how we positioned the brand. And as you look at, you know, global luxury brands, those levels of positioning, that positioning, getting that positioning right is really critical. And I'll just show you a couple of examples of things that are going on in the world, which we're involved in, some of which we are, you know, we think are good. So content. Now, we talked about the role of content, because actually, you know, your opportunity in luxury marketing to buy media is often one that's a little bit challenged. You use a lot of publicity, PR activities to get into the market because you like being, you know, the brands as such like being talked about. So traditional, if you like, FMCG media strategies tend not to work with this market. So it's much more about creating packages of content and experiences that are interesting. And this is really a way of bringing a digital experience to life. So this is an example of Jaguar, who've recently, you know, at the Frankfurt Motor Show, showed a concept car. And the process of showing a concept car, once upon a time in that world, say three years ago, it would be very journalist-led, trade journalist-led, industry-led. So very inward-looking, actually. So silk cloth over thing, show it off, everyone claps and everyone goes away. And they hope that lots of motoring journalists will write about it. Increasingly, that's moved from being one that's not just about the trade, but is about the world. So engaging the whole world in an experience like that has become the brief. And that's quite interesting. So in this instance, the Frankfurt Motor Show, how do you do that? I mentioned before provenance and authenticity. So Julian Thompson, who's the guy who designed this particular concept vehicle, works for Jaguar, a very smart guy, lovely actually. We did a conversation with him where questions could be asked, and it's similar, if you like, and some of you, I'm sure, will have heard of Burberry and the work that Chris Bailey did to open up either the behind the scenes, or Dennis at Dolce & Gabbana originally putting bloggers at the front row of the shows. Well, bringing that, if you like, authenticity and that experience to the world is now possible. And it's possible with infrastructure and with a team and an attitude to be able to deliver against that, because it's not that simple to suddenly go, oh, let's get people who haven't been used to necessarily talking to the public before doing so. Okay, so that's one way of doing it. So you kind of make heroes out of the hero products that you have. And bring those reveals to life as well at first. It's where the digital experience is now the first place most people will experience your brand. And that's really important to understand. Because what it does, it changes. Does it change what the brand is about? No. But what it does, it changes the way that you have to operate to make that brand real and put it in front of people. Being, I think, you know, content as well is something that you can react to. So, you know, in this instance, Top Gear did a story about the F-Type. So, okay, let's get them on the road. Which is actually, you know, seeing these things is often a big part of putting them out into the market. Another point as well is just actually engaging, because this is a big part. You know, so much of Twitter and Facebook from these brands is all about, here's what we do, here's what we do. There's no engagement at all. It's sort of a management. Oh, blimey, somebody said something nasty. Let's stop that. But it's very much about if you actually have a policy and a strategy to create some level of engagement where you respond, you listen, you respond, you listen, you respond, then the truth in your brand and the belief in the values that you have as a brand that is able to do that can change and do a lot of good. So in this instance, you know, here's people talking about the F-Type and being responded to by the brand itself. And you have to see, this is an enormous change. Well, you wouldn't know, necessarily 3 years ago, this particular brand wouldn't have dreamed of doing this kind of activity. So the journey that they've been on to set up people in the business that are able to think like that, to have an infrastructure and a supply chain that's able to deliver digital content, to have a point of view about managing a community, to have a point of view about what to say on Twitter, because everybody thinks it's a great idea to have a Twitter account, but actually, what are you going to say for the next 3 years, twice daily? You know, having a strategy of the content and having the mindset to deliver it is important. And does it drive to value, and does it drive to a point where an engagement or a lead can be generated or a sale can be made? Absolutely. It's a big part of it. So this is where, you know, actually this is where we come in, because we make that kind of inbound environment for Jaguar. So when you go and you can look at the car, you configure it, you choose one, you find a dealer, that's the whole stream of consumer or customer, if you like, through the process to test one out. But ultimately, it's all about getting people to try one out. And the mobile application for that, by the way, is the most trafficked. Because that's why we talked before about, you know, are these people on? Is digital important? Absolutely it is. Mobile first. This mobile is just part and parcel of it now, actually. Really important. Okay? And that's it from me. In terms of what? I'd like to ask if you've got any questions or ask you some questions. Anybody got any questions? It's all so good. It was early in the morning, I appreciate that. Okay, so can I ask you some questions? How about you? How far have you come to get here today?
From Birmingham.
From Birmingham?
Yeah.
Okay. That's not too far. No? Did you come on the Virgin?
Yeah. Virgin.
Virgin.
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. And what is it? Why have you come today? You're exhibiting, okay. Well, that's a very good reason. Okay. Anyway, sorry, I don't mean to pounce on people, but it's often quite a good way of just getting people. It's very early in the morning. How about you? You're smiling a lot, which is a good call.
Yeah, but...
Doing anything?
Yeah,
say no, it's fine.
No, it's just interesting to listen to someone okay. from a different perspective, so...
Great, okay, thank you. Anyone else want to say anything? No? Yes? Go on, then.
Oh, I don't... No, I didn't.
No.
Okay. Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the day.
Don't worry, this is my third day and I've hardly heard anybody ask
I know,
any questions.